WORJ-FM, Mount Dora, Orlando, Zeta107.7, and that's Jethro Tull. You just listened to Dark Ages from their new LP. We're just about to get on with our hour special tonight on the Lynyrd Skynyrd Band, interviews and music. We'll be starting that in just a minute or two. At the Volunteer Jam, long live the Lynyrd Skynyrd Band. They will be back, and soon, as the Rossington Collins Band. Gary Rossington and Alan Collins on guitars, Artemis Pyle back behind the drums, Leon Wilkerson on bass, and Billy Powell on piano. Guitarist Barry Harwood will be with the band as well, and there will surely be many special guests. Right now, we're going to take you back to an earlier time, a happier time for Skynyrd fans, to a time just after the release of the third album. The country was just starting to catch on to this new southern rock sound, and Lynyrd Skynyrd's star was on the rise.
I'm Ronnie, the singer, and I'm from Jacksonville.
You're from Jacksonville, Florida? Mm-hmm. Is the whole band from Jacksonville?
Come on, man. That's where we live.
All over the side.
The drummer right here from Spartanburg, South Carolina.
What's the drummer's name?
Artemis Pyle.
The southern name. What's your name?
Bill Powell.
Bill? What do you play, Bill?
Play piano. Strictly piano.
Yeah?
Gary. Gary? Sing guitar.
Yeah.
Leon Wilkerson, bass.
Alan Collins, guitar.
And guitar. This is a big band. You got, what, seven guys in the band? Yeah. How long has Lynyrd Skynyrd been together?
The singer and two of the guitar players. They've been together for like 9 years.
9 years?
Been better of 10.
Yeah?
The group that's playing right now has been together going on, what, 3 years? 3 years. That's great.
Is it true that the name Lynyrd Skynyrd came from a high school athletic coach or something? Or phys ed director?
That's a question we get asked most often. And it is true. He was a gym coach for Gary, guitar player, and an old drummer that we used to have. Used to make him get the hair cut all the time, and finally got fed up with it and quit, and we wanted to play music anyway, you know. Mm-hmm. And after we got out and started the group and things started happening a little bit, we decided we had to have a name, so we made a big joke out of it and named it after him, you know.
This is in Jacksonville?
This is in Jacksonville.
Is he still there?
Yes, he is. Jacksonville? Yes, he is. He's a real estate man.
Yeah. What is, did you ever get in touch with him? What does he think
of his articles in the paper and all that stuff? He seems to be very happy about it. He's getting a lot of promotion out of it, you know. Yeah. We won't comment on the way we think about him, you know. But, no hard feelings.
I take it you weren't friends?
Not at the time, no.
Strictly because of the fact that he told you to cut your hair? Or just a basic hard-ass attitude?
Well, see, he was a gym coach, and both of the guys were athletes, and this particular time, you had to have your hair cut, to wear a football helmet and all that stuff, and we didn't believe that, so finally, we just let our hair grow and quit playing sports, and he didn't dig that, and we played music, and it turned out best for us, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The song we hear most often over the phone, this request for Lynyrd Skynyrd, is Freebird. Who wrote that?
Alan and myself wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the oldest song that we do. We wrote it about 5 years ago.
It's also one of the best. There's a lot of radio stations that play a cut version of it.
Well, I think the group feels different about that. It's probably the most exciting song that we do on stage, you know, more energy. It's been, we got three guitar players that we're very proud of, and the whole song is designed, the rhythm pattern behind it, just to let them go to show what they can do. As far as the pattern of the song and the complication of the song, putting it together and all, it's probably one of the easiest ones that we do.
Mm-hmm. What's this now? Nuthin Fancy is album number 3, is that right? You're making $1 million now?
We never even stopped to think about that.
Yeah. I often wonder, because, you know, like, you travel around a lot, and you're, like, on a retainer of some kind, I guess, a salary.
Sure.
Yeah. So the money goes to your equipment, and to your, you have an accountant who takes care of all the bread.
We have an accountant that takes care of everything for us and trying to look after us in the future when there is no more Leonard Skinnard, you know. Mm-hmm.
Do you see that day coming?
Of course it'll come. It always has to come, you know, but... Fortunately, we got good people behind us, and that because we don't have no education and stuff like that, then we'll have something to fall back on when Leonard Skinnard is.
It's also a new number of that one. No, true story. To go home, never had a dime. Lord, we always had a good time. And I recall drinking wine with one of my friends. Lord, I can't go back again. Am I losing my own way back home? Am I losing a good friend that I've known? Am I losing? Won't you tell me how I'm seeing? Why am I losing one of my best friends? And I recall this friend of mine I knew so well. Goes to show, Lord, you just can't tell. Now my friend won't talk to me. Let me tell you why. Thinks I've changed because of a dollar sign. Oh, am I losing my own way back home? Am I losing a good friend that I've known? Am I losing? Won't you tell me how I'm seeing? Why am I losing one of my best? Am I losing once again? Why these things happen, Lord, I don't understand. The Lord sure hurt a man. Why won't my friend take me as I am? Cause your friend, Lord, is the most important thing. Oh, am I losing my own way back home? Am I losing a good friend that I've known? Am I losing? Won't you tell me how I sing? Why am I losing one of my best friends? Oh, tell me, people, now what good is that? Thank you.
The band's been really successful after only 3 albums. Really successful. I think in the last 6 months to a year, you've caught on hotter than most of the bands in the country at this point.
We feel we've been very lucky.
Really?
Very
lucky. Just a matter of luck.
blessed.
Yeah, dream come true.
Yeah.
On stage, is your show really simple? Is there any flash to it at all? Or do you get up and play the music?
None whatsoever. No flash, no nothing. We just simply try to play tight.
Mm-hmm.
And we feel that's where it's at.
How do you like playing in Miami?
This is the second time, right?
Mm-hmm.
We played
the stadium last time, didn't we?
Orange Bowl.
Sportatorium?
Last time was in the Orange Bowl, yeah. We played with the Duke
band, Leon.
What?
No, it wasn't.
It was with the Eagles and
the Orange Bowl Eagles. And
Sportatorium.
And right before that, in Hollywood, was with the Duke Brothers.
Yeah.
Which is right outside of Miami.
You're going to play at the stadium this time. You've never played a Miami Marine?
No, never have. Very excited about this.
Mm.
We've been told we don't know yet that we have to get there by boat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
Yeah, you got to take a boat out.
We're going to
go fishing on the way.
We're going to fetch a fishing pole and trouble out there and see if we can catch some fish on the way out. Yeah?
When you do it, you know, when you play, when they have concerts there, they sell passes to boats, and you see about 200 of them out in the water listening to your music.
I think that's beautiful.
It's pretty thrilling, yeah. You did a tour with The Who last year.
Two years ago.
How did you like touring with The Who?
We'd never played a major concert in our life until we got hooked up with The Who, and then the first major concert we played was with The Who at the Cow Palace in San Francisco. And it scared us to death. And I think they taught us a lot. After we played with The Who on that big tour, we've never had what you'd call a real stage fright again, you know,
really?
Any crowd.
What did they teach you exactly that you think is so worthwhile? So
professionalism. We had to go up there and leave the stage hot, for one thing. We had to get the people not to boo us off. And the first couple jobs, we were scared. And after that, we had people getting out of their seats and coming up to the front of the stage to see us. I wasn't seeing them 2 years ago, and any other act that would open up for them and get through it all. And we were determined.
Really?
Hold our own.
It's pretty hard to go up there when they're all sitting there waiting for The Who. You didn't get booed off this time, huh?
No way.
That's a big turning point.
We became very close friends. We, after the show, we were being dressed in the room with them, and just can't say enough about those people. They're just not only geniuses, but forget the music, Peter Townsend, and all the people, just beautiful.
And,
I mean, they respect younger musicians and try to help them in any way they can.
Mm-hmm. There's no barriers or walls between you.
Right, not at all whatsoever.
Were they the ones that wanted you guys to tour with them? Is that how that
originally they didn't want to do? They didn't want to have a band tour with them at all.
They didn't want a front band.
And
they had a choice of bands.
Tour with them because they just wanted to do the show themselves because of the same record label. There was a lot of things pulled. You know, we finally got on the tour, and the third night, I think, in Los Angeles, we played Peter Townsend. You know, we weren't about to go near them. Pete Townsend walked in our dressing room and said we were the best band he ever played with. From then on, they took care of us. They made sure that we weren't treated like a bunch of dogs, you know.
Yeah, they called us rednecks.
The last couple of years, Southern music has really taken off, and I suppose that's due in part to bands like the Almonds and the Marshall Tucker Band.
We hit it right on the nail. If it hadn't have been for Dwayne and Greg Almond opening up the door and all for other Southern bands, and we'd probably still be down here playing clubs.
Mm-hmm.
They brought attention to the South.
Why did it take so long for that to happen? Personally, I mean, there's obviously been a lot of talent in the South for a long time.
Well, people from the South are always making it, and for a long time.
Oh, yeah, you got your fads like you had your, you know, the California groups. You know, they had their thing. You know, and died out a little bit. New York had their thing. Seems like South comes last. You know?
Does it ever happen that you get on stage and collectively can't get any energy up at all and just, you know, there's nothing there?
Yeah, for sure.
Does it show? Do you feel like the audience picks up on that?
Oh, yes, it does.
I say it's if the audience is up for it. We've gone on stage one time where Gary would be sick, I would be tired, get up on stage there, and the people are ready for it. We play one of the best shows you ever played, you know. Mm-hmm.
And you're back again.
You know, it really does. It's psychological.
Yeah.
How you really feel.
Sometimes you can feel that you're going to have a great gig, and sometimes you can feel done. On the other hand, you know, you don't really know what to expect.
Right. I'm just talking to the girl. I think we're going to have a good one tonight. We all feel good.
Yes.
We're going to play a little bit off the first album, a little bit off the second, and a lot off a third album that'll be out Monday in Chattanooga. This one's off a new album. City is 1,000 miles away, and if you ask me, I tell you that's okay. Well, I'm not trying to put the Big Apple down. They don't need a man like me in town. Well, I pick cotton down on the Dixie line. I work all day trying to make a dime, but that's all right. It's okay by me, 'cause that's the way it was meant to be. But big city hard times never bother me. I'm a country boy, as happy as I can be. I don't like smoking, choking up my air, and some of those city folks, well, they don't care. I don't like cars buzzing around. I don't even want a piece of concrete in my town. Well, I like sunshine, fresh, clean air. Makes me feel like, well, you wouldn't care. But that's alright. Each to his own. But one smell from a city, and a country boy's gone. I said, big city hard times never bother me. I'm a country boy, I'm as happy as I can be. Well, I don't want to even read about it. I'm a country boy. Something, and let me tell you the truth. What's right for me might not be right for you. Well, you live your way, I live mine, and I hope you're happy all the time. But I pick cotton down on the Dixie line. I work all day trying to make a dime, but that's all right. Okay by me, 'cause that's the way it was supposed to be. But makes it a hard time, never bother me. I'm a country boy, I'm as happy as I can be. What I say, baby, I say, makes it a hard time, never bother me. I'm a country boy, I'm as happy as I can be. Oh, that's my way, baby. I don't want you to tell me about the big city. I don't want to even read about it. Oh, I'm a hunter boy. I'm a
country boy.
When did you become a headliner band? How long ago this happened?
Well, we've been headlining after the Who tour off and on in different cities. Like this major tour, we're headlining everywhere. Which I really don't think it means that much. And it don't make any difference to us when we play.
It doesn't make any difference in the dollar figures that you take in?
We never even know. We don't know how much money we're making tonight.
Yeah.
And really don't care. You know?
Really?
We're here to try to do the best we can for the people.
We'll be back to this interview with Lynyrd Skynyrd, music from them, on our Memorial Day to Lynyrd Skynyrd here on Zeta 7 in just a moment.
What cities were you hitting over there?
We did them all. We did every place in England.
We did Germany, Scotland, Glasgow, Newcastle, Bristol, Brighton, Paris, France.
Brussels.
Yeah. Brussels. I mean,
right to Holland.
It was nice. We did London, England twice. Headlined the Rainbow there, the second time there.
Was there any city in particular where your music was, say, accepted better than the others?
Oh, yeah.
England.
Also, that one thing in Germany that we did, there was a lot of American soldiers there.
They said the European audiences are harder to please. It's harder to get any kind of reaction out of them at all. How did you guys feel playing the kind of, you know, gut kind of music that you play, energy kind of stuff?
I think the only weird gig I could think of was in Hamburg, and then plus it was being televised, where it was really had really the bright spots all the way
different over there. The police and all the kids are not allowed to get up and boogie. About the first time they charge the stage, they'll charge them right back, you know, and they're ruthless with them. So the kids sit there, and sometimes you don't even know if you're going over good or not, and you just keep on playing. And then when you finish, then they'll let you know. You know, and then they'll let you know good, you know.
Because the audiences know they have to stay in reserve?
Right. Most of the halls over there are real fancy, like Avery Fisher or something, real clean halls.
They listen
like
more there.
They do listen more.
Jump around and, you know, get it boogie.
How does that affect your show and your play?
We like it.
Yeah.
We like for an audience to listen, get into the music. I don't care. We don't care that much about boogies, you know. We like to do the music.
We definitely have a reputation of boogie hard rock and all that stuff. But this group, they definitely would rather take their time and just sit back and play. You know.
That's it.
And on this tour, we've been doing that a pretty good bit. You know? Just laying back.
Now, is it true you guys bust up hotel rooms? What's the story now? Huh?
Those days are gone.
Are they?
But not forgotten.
You're kidding me.
Oh, what? Almost.
When you're talking about the Who, I was thinking about how Peter Townsend does his destructive act on stage. I don't know what they do when they
go. The United States government's going to take a lot of tax money from them, you know, before they go back and all. So they just have a good time, you know. They buy 50, 60 get cars, they spend the money, you know, before the income tax people take it from them.
Do you get into that, though? Do you ever, you know, get so crazy on the road that you start busting things up inside hotel rooms?
What he does.
Yeah.
Just takes all your frustrations out instead of going out and fighting or something.
We're real good at burning TVs up, but thank God. Pour the back and it's gone.
You pour what?
You pour scotch, water, mostly scotch, you know, but anything, we just throw it in the back.
See the smoke come up, and that's it. That's
the manager of the Holiday Inn.
I got on fire one time.
Manager of the Holiday Inn was listening. We're only kidding.
You know what happens is that it's a very moody group, and sometimes we'll have a bad gig, you know, and then everybody gets back up the next day, you know, and we just got to do better than last night, you know, and then it turns out worse. Then everybody starts going, wow, you know, what's happening? Trying to figure out what's going wrong. And then the next night, maybe, it'd be the same thing. And then you come back to the hotel, you know, and just go, oh, my God, you know. Sometimes the next day, it's really good, you know.
And you come back and wash your TV and just clean it.
Yeah.
Once you get all that crap out of your head, once you clean your heads up, then it always seems to work out better. I guess if you got to take it out on something, you might as well take it out on a hotel room. What the hell?
Yeah, we had to pay for it. We used to drink a terrible lot before we played until this tour. And that had a lot to do with it, you know. And,
what did you do? Give it up?
Drunk? Yeah, we gave it up.
Beer here. One beer, maybe.
Was it getting in the way of your music?
Yes, it was ruining me. I had to go to several throat doctors, and they said it was ruining me, you know. So they said I had no choice, you know, either quit whiskey or it'd ruin my voice within the next year or so, and I'd be in the Alcoholics Anonymous place and all. It wasn't a really hard decision to make, you know, so I quit. I feel a whole lot better. The group feels a whole lot better.
Put your hands Look here, big man. Well, won't you give me 3 steps? Give me 3 steps, mister. Give me 3 steps for the door. Give me 3 steps. Give me 3 steps, mister. You'll never see me no more. Woo-hoo! Show me the back door.
Bottom of a sea. Oh, some old fool. Friday night special. And I'd like to tell you what you can do with your shoes. On the island. On the sweet day.
Return to the concluding segment of tonight's Lynyrd Skynyrd interview on our Memorial to Lynyrd Skynyrd Day here at Zeta 7 right after these words.
So how do you feel about touring 80 cities? You gonna make it through?
Yeah, we did it before.
We're gonna do it.
Yeah. Out of 80 cities, how many gigs are you gonna play where you come off stage satisfied with what you do?
If we come out with 40, we'll be happy.
Half the time.
Yeah.
We don't care really about the audience things. We like coming off the stage knowing that the band had a good tight set.
Yeah.
We're more pleased when the band is right on it.
There's so many details that goes into it. Like,
really, there is.
The building that you play, the sound you're going to get, the acoustics, you know. Whether the sound system's going to mess up or somebody going to blow an amp or something like that. You know. Blow the momentum of a group, and even though the crowd loves it, you know, I mean, they keep right on going, you know, it still bothers us.
Yeah.
You know, and very seldom do you find a gig where everything went just right.
Does everybody solo? Do you get into soloing on stage?
Piano player solos, all three guitar players solo, constantly switching off back and forth.
Yeah.
I do very little. And the bass and the drums are most important.
There's always most important. A solid foundation
most
with whatever's going on
by the group.
Is there one guy in the group who is the solid foundation when you're performing? Somebody who kind of keeps it all together and keeps it rolling?
It has to be the drummer. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, that's it. I think.
You said Ronnie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How come? The front man that the audience pays more
No, I'm trying to figure out who the guy is who just kind of holds it all together, you know, because everybody's doing each thing.
You mean musically?
Yeah.
I think it'd be the bass and the drums, really.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, just a foundation.
As far as something definite, that's like a pattern, so everything doesn't fall apart.
Because you extrapolate, you go off. Just about, you know, not knowing where you're going sometimes. I suppose you do a lot of that, don't you?
Musically?
Yeah.
No, I pretty much know.
You know what you're going to do?
What you're talking about with me is after each song, you know, after a couple of songs, when we get into a set, then a couple of groups a little bit excited or tensed up a little bit or something, you know, then in between a song, tell them to slow down just a little bit, we're rushing a little bit or something like that. You know.
From song to
lay
song?
Back or sit down or
yeah.
Whenever
what's necessary. What's this one because, you know, you played the last one too fast and this tempo's got to be right and all. Of course, the crowd never hears that. You know.
Yeah, right.
We've got to work on that.
Let me ask you guys what you really think about doing this kind of thing, about the whole promotional aspect of selling records and concert tours and everything. Do you get behind that? Are you really up for this kind of thing, or is it a drag for you?
I think we try and keep an eye on what's going on because we don't want it to turn into a big hype. We want to get on the unreal stage. We'd like to keep everything in perspective, pretty much real.
We just want to play.
We don't like bullshit. Hate bullshit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a certain amount of bullshit to any kind of performing records. You got to pay those kind of dues to keep your name in front of people and sell the albums, I guess, and get booked in as headliners.
Yeah, but I tell you, we really cut down on a lot of bullshit.
Yep. And you only have so much time. You spend part of it playing and part of it having a good time. The other part's set aside for this kind of thing, so I don't suppose you want to spend too much time doing it.
We work 24 hours a day.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How do you do it?
Dedicated to this.
How do you keep going like that? It's really tough.
Well, if we couldn't do it, you know, then we'd have to pick cotton, you know, so we got to pick cotton.
There you go. A real alternative, yeah.
We really enjoy it, you know. It's just, it's our life. That's all there is to it.
We'd like to play a little back porch music for you now, if we can.
When I look in your face, baby, when I look in your eyes, I can tell pretty mama I've been wasting time. Well, you don't really love me, you just want me for what I am. But you better treat me right, woman. Gonna lose your money, man. Well, when I first met you, baby, was red like a girl. But I tried to take you to a better world. But you would not listen. Still you think I am a fool. Well, you had it made in the shade, babe. Don't let that tree fall down on you. Girl, you a silly fool, play. Well, I work real hard trying to make my pay. Lord, I never tell you what you supposed to do. Well, you had it made in shape. Tree falls down on you. Well, you had it made in shade, babe. Don't let that tree fall down on you. Girl, you are silly fool. Tree falls down on you.
thing. Woo! A little back porch music. Yeah. We're gonna play another new tune for us about a train. It's called Railroad Song. Switch over to guitars in a second. Y'all take your time. We got some time, so just relax. We're gonna have a good time tonight. Yeah.
So I asked a policeman, can I stay here long? He said, Mr. Hubba, you got to go now. We don't want you around. See, I'm trying to build me a respectable town. Don't be a hobo like you hanging around. So I left that town, Lord, I had my guitar in my hand. Still cold, tired, and dirty, kind of mad at the man. But this life I chose to live, sometimes strange. See, I'm trying to learn about the old music from riding the train. Well, I'm a hobo, I know, and that's the price I'll pay. So write me another song while I'm on my way. I'm on, catch me a freight train. This is what I'm saying. It's the choo-choo train. Take me away. Get a coma train. Till I find out what Jimmy Rogers and the Hag was all about. Well, I play this rock and roll, and I think that's fine. But I'd like to go back, Lord, a little further in time. Well, I'm a hobo, I know, and that's the price I'll pay. Guess I'll write me another song while I'm on my way. I'm on, gets me a freight train. This is what I'll say. It's the choo-choo train. Suits your song, man.
I say one thing. Please let me say one thing. Can I say one thing? They make a better audience than Winterland, Mr. Bill Grimm's Winterland. I never seen it. If I could do a new song for you, it's called On the Hunt.
I know who you are. like you, I'm always hunting.
We ain't much on talking. Never have been able to talk too much. But we know how to say thank y'all. Thank y'all very much. Thank you. And I'm as free as a bird. I thank you all too.
Too many places I've got to see.